everyone else, I've recently been in the United States, and it was a fantastic experience. In fact, and we were in Los Angeles, so we passed by this wonderful National Center for the Preservation of Democracy, and I got delighted and said, "Oh, wow, we should have such a thing in Europe."
Isn't that like a very conservative thing?
And then it turned out that it was closed. And recently, President Obama had an address at the Correspondents' Dinner, and what he said is this: "This is a time around the world when some of the fundamental ideals of liberal democracies are under attack, and when notions of objectivity and of a free press and of facts and of evidence are trying to be undermined, or in some cases ignored entirely. And in such a climate, it's not enough just to give people a megaphone. That's why your power," he's talking to the press, "and your responsibility to dig and to question and to counter distortions and untruths is more important than ever." And I think we should take that seriously as well. So, why do we need democracy in future? And also a new kind of capitalism. Why do we need to upgrade this system? Well, first of all, we need to realize we are in a time of change. Capitalism is being reinvented by companies that come from the heart of capitalism, Silicon Valley, right? And Uber is such a company. It doesn't own any taxis, but it basically organizes most taxi trips in the world. And same thing with Airbnb, they don't own any beds in any hotels, but they're basically now the biggest hotel chain in a sense, because they're coordinating stays overnight. So it becomes visible that basically use of resources becomes more important than ownership. And we see that also in the music business, where streaming becomes more important now than buying music titles, and also in the video business and so on. And we've also seen Bitcoin, which is challenging classical banks, and where basically you can create money with your computer. You can do that now. That's amazing. And we've also seen companies build 3D printers to build houses. And in fact, there's a Chinese investor who wants to build the biggest building in the world within a week's time in his life. And I trust he might be able to do that. So anyway, what we see is that everything is transformed. The way we go shopping, the way we produce, the way we move, we do research, we educate, the health system, politics, the economy, the financial business, insurance business, and even war. Everything. I think it's even challenging, actually, churches and maybe religion. And what we see is really something that is pretty much alike to the Industrial Revolution, but much faster and maybe much more fundamental. So, in history, humankind has gone through transformations several times, like from transition from agricultural to industrial society, and from industrial to the service society. These were such kinds of transitions. Now we'll see a transition to the digital society, and of course, automation and robotics is part of this. And this is challenging classical jobs, in particular routine jobs. And in fact, a lot of jobs are routine jobs. So people believe that about 50% of today's jobs will be gone in 10 to 20 years. And that will create a pressure also on the employment. In fact, we already see in some countries that unemployment of young people skyrockets and surpasses 50%. And this is something that can endanger social and political peace in Europe. And in fact, there are just a few countries left, such as Switzerland, Austria, Germany, Sweden, that still offer jobs to young people. For in other countries, it's much more difficult. And this is not just a challenge to employees, it's also a challenge to companies, because according to statistics, 40% of today's top 500 companies will be gone in 10 years, period. And so, Günther Oettinger, who is the commissioner responsible for the digital transformation in the European Union, he says, we are in the digital struggle for survival. By 2020, he says, it will be decided who survives this in 2000. And he's talking not just about companies, I believe, but also about countries, right? So this is a serious issue. And it's so fast. Now, when we started to work on the Future ICT project, there was almost no reporting about the digital revolution and big data and artificial intelligence and Internet of Things. Now, by now, there's so many articles, I have difficulties following all those articles. So there's a massive change, really. And what does that mean for our society? Well, it's good to consult a history book, and it would tell you that we've gone through these transformations several times, but these transformations were highly disruptive. So there have been financial and economic crises, but also revolutions and wars, right? Obviously, we have a financial and economic crisis already, and we don't want to have a revolution or war, but if we just go on as we've done in the past, apply the same success principles, and we would automatically run into a revolution or war. Because the nature of this transition is that past success principles turn into principles that fail, and new success principles come up, and I believe this will be co-creation, co-evolution, and collective intelligence. And that has to do with the networked nature of this digital society. Now, all of these developments bring our society to a crossroads. There are different ways to organize data-driven societies, and we could end up in fascism 2.0, a Big Brother or Brave New World society, or a communism 2.0, one could call a Big Mother society, based on the idea of a benevolent dictator that tries to be just, redistribute the resources if needed, and these kind of things. And there's also feudalism 2.0, the big other society. Some people also call surveillance capitalism. All of those forms of societies don't appeal to me very much, and I'm not sure which one would you choose. Don't look very happy too. So the question is privacy dead? And being a former sociologist, maybe also ask, is sociology dead? And is democracy dead? So about privacy, right? Whenever you go shopping, you produce data traces. It doesn't matter whether you buy online or in a shop. When you move, it produces data traces. When you make friends, when you store your files, if you use a cloud or a mail account, your mail would be screened for certain keywords. They say it's for your better service, whatever. And there are these readers like Amazon's Kindle, and they're actually reading the readers, in a sense, right? They're storing what kind of books are you reading, how much time do you spend on a certain page, what do you mark, what are your comments, and all these kind of things. So Amazon is learning about you in this way. Google learns about you in a different way. So they basically know what you're thinking about if you type in some Google query, and Apple could listen what you're saying. Not sure they're doing that all the time, but at least if you're actively using it, Apple knows And if you watch a movie, it will be known. And if Google Glass would come, then basically they would know what's happening around you and almost everyone. And maybe the entire world would know, depending on Google's strategy. And then maybe you have a game console at home that would watch you in your living room. And why not collect fingerprints and genetic material, right? And all of this is obviously on the way, right? And this is happening. Okay, so the question is what to do with that kind of situation, right? Then the next question is democracy dead? And here's one interesting quote by Peter Thiel. He says, "We are in a deadly race between politics and technology." And I think he hopes that technology will win. And it's not so clear what's his vision of this future world. I mean, he's investing into all sorts of companies. And I think he actually believes that we just don't need politics. It's just creating friction. As he probably thinks that we don't need banks, it's just creating friction, right? So he, for example, he supports blockchain technology, and I think blockchain technology can be used for many good things, and I'll talk about this later on. I still think, on the other hand, that we probably need a little bit of politics also in the future, right? So we'd be careful to erase it completely. Is democracy dead? Tony Blair asked this question some time ago, 2014. And actually this question has been asked also in other newspapers. Is the Demokratie ein Auslaufmodell? Here it's already claimed it's an Auslaufmodell, so it's about to end. And here a similar statement in Switzerland. And in fact, in the Silicon Valley we have seen quotes like this. Democracy is an outdated technology. It has produced wealth and health and happiness of billions of people all over the world, but now we want to do something new, period. Right? And the question is, will this new thing be better than what we had before? And at least we're seeing that all sorts of people are trying new things now. I mean, Erdogan, for example, right? So basically, Turkish democracy is almost dead. Polish democracy is in a similar state, maybe not as bad. And France's democracy is also not in good shape, according to the United Nations and others. So, what about sociology? Some people have asked me already now, does it have a meaning that you turned into a computational social scientist? Does it mean sociology is dead? Who knows? So, I mean, in principle, the idea now is that you could build something like an X-ray for society. That allows you to see what happens, right? To see what is wrong, or where the system is broken, and it looks like a brilliant idea. And most likely it is, if you do it in the right way. And in fact, it's not surprising that CERN, for example, is excited about this vision, it seems, and that they want to apply the algorithm that they're using to identify patterns in the data that their detectors have been producing, that they want to transfer the same kind of algorithms and technology, in a sense, to society, to learn about people's behavior. And in fact, people like Stephen Wolfram, who has come up with Mathematica and is also behind Wolfram Alpha, the search engine that's used by Bing. He said humans are more predictable than elementary particles. It's kind of shocking. So, should people be treated like elementary particles? Should physicists investigate society, or does it need sociologists still, and psychologists and economists? You know, that's a question. Does it need ethics and all this kind of thing? So it seems like by now CERN is up to speed. They have built this oracle, the crystal ball, using machine learning technology. So this has recently happened. And in fact, I've proposed myself that we should build a CERN for the social sciences. And it was Heinz Gutscher, to be precise, the president of the Swiss Academy of Arts and Sciences at that time, who used that term for the first time. We've been using terms like knowledge accelerator, innovation accelerator, knowledge collider, very much inspired by the big project and ambitious project of CERN. But our goal was to create an open, value-oriented information system for the world. So this is the overview of the architecture of the Future ICT flagship project. If you look at this, in other words, the Dirac nervous system, the living Earth simulator, and beyond this, a global participatory platform to open up the potential of this technology for everyone. Social-inspired ICT, global systems science, and then exploratories for financial systems, health and epidemic, crime and conflict, risk, resilience, sustainable cities, smart energy systems, environment and sustainability, and an innovation accelerator. But across everything, there is ethics, right? And I think this open participatory character in the ethics has been left out. And this is concerning because there's some people like Larry Page who say things like this. There are a lot of things that we would like to try out, but unfortunately we cannot do them because it's illegal. Because there are laws that don't allow to do these kind of things. So we should have a few places where we are safe, where we can try out new things and find out what implications would it have for society. They want to do illegal things. You know, this is pretty explicit, right? And that's why the CERN scene is a little bit special, because it's not subject to national legislation. It's extraterritorial domain. And the question, what are the limitations of what one can do over there, right? And so, certainly, I'm absolutely for science and for visionary science. I'm for technology and for visionary projects, but I think we shouldn't sacrifice the foundations of society as we've learned them over hundreds of years as a result of many battles and wars. And there are a lot of things that would be stupid to throw away because it took such a big effort to get there. So what I'm saying is, okay, let's use all that technology, but let's make sure there's public control, it will be scientifically used, and it means there should be interdisciplinary teams of people, not just physicists and computer scientists, but also social scientists, economists, ecologists, all sorts of people who seem could make a contribution and might have something to say about these kind of things. Ethical use, transparency, accountability, security, and we always need to be aware that powerful instruments, as those that are being built, not only at CERN, but in many other places of the world, they attract people with all sorts of motivations, including organized criminals, extremists, terrorists, people with extreme political agendas, and some of them are good enough to get access to such kind of tools. We've seen so many cases of hacking recently, even the Pentagon, the White House, the military, the US military, also here, recent hacking cases in Switzerland, in Germany, the Bundestag, and so on. No, so there is no evidence we could build these systems in a safe way, so it couldn't be corrupted. Also, the Swiss financial money transfer system, SWIFT, you know, has been hacked. So we don't know systems, I believe, that couldn't be hacked. Now, but anyway, no, I don't want to be negative at all. So we need to ask the question, can big data fix the world? And what are the limits? So within just a minute, 700,000 Google queries are sent, and 500,000 Facebook comments, and people move, that leaves data traces, and they buy, and they do all sorts of things. And so that produces digital trace that allows us to reconstruct what's going on in the world, and it can be used for good. So for example, to understand epidemic spreading and to contain it, to understand knowledge production, and also the spreading of ideas and culture and all these kind of things. And we're working on such kinds of projects, and I think these were amazing projects and have created important insights. So the question is, what else can we do, right? And Chris Anderson has come up with this claim that we would see the end of theory. That basically, if we just had enough data, the scientific method would be obsolete, which means that basically all of you would be unemployed, because we don't need you anymore, right? I mean, you should realize this is the implication, right? And if you don't agree, then maybe you should have a public opinion on this. But anyway, so let's look into this. Is he right or not? So the idea was really, if you just collect enough data, and that's why companies and governments have collected as much data as they could. The idea was, if you just have enough data, the truth would reveal itself, right? So they had most likely the very best intentions. And the idea was, hey, could we maybe know everything that goes on in the world? Could we see it as it happens in any corner of the world? You know, isn't that amazing? Is it strange to build a digital crystal ball? Yeah, who wouldn't want to have such a thing secretly shown? You know, like maybe you would feel uncomfortable if other people had it, but you know, who wouldn't want to have such a thing? And would it be possible to really optimize the world now, if you just had enough data? Could we rule it like a wise king or a benevolent dictator? Yeah, that sounds so plausible. That we just couldn't do a better job in the past because we were lacking the data. And now we can have the data. So we can do a perfect job. That's the idea that sounds so plausible. And so it's no wonder that Google wants to reprogram the state. I mean, they're not just producing an operating system for your computer or your smartphone, but for the entire society, right? And you need to realize this. And IBM does the same thing. You know, there's this campaign, Watson for President, commenting on qualities of presidential candidates here, but some people think a computer could run an entire nation or the entire world. And before we do that, we should look into this, right? And the concern is that computers are still not reliable. Yes, this is self-evident. Thank you, Apple. Thank you, Microsoft. No, we don't know. It's probably an interaction effect. So, this magic formula that sounds so plausible, that more data means more knowledge, and more knowledge means more power, and more power means more success, that unfortunately doesn't work. at least not always. And one of the prime examples of big data analytics was Google flu trends. In the beginning, it worked quite well, but then it turns out it actually is not so reliable anymore. And if you look at into this list of top 10 or even top 20 cities of the world in terms of livability, quality of life, surprisingly, none of the big IT nations is on here. So, you know, if it was so easy to use big data and turn a city or a country into a paradise, you know, we should see this. It should show up here. And it hasn't happened so far. Just read a newspaper article about in Silicon Valley, they're now considering to build social housing for people earning less than $250,000 a year. You know, all those poor techies that can't afford a reasonable apartment. Yeah, so these are the kind of problems, and I wish we can solve them all together, because obviously, you know, something is not yet perfect here. More data does not necessarily mean more knowledge. You know, if you look into the sky, then you see patterns, right? And some people think these patterns have a meaning, but from the point of view of science, most of those patterns don't have a meaning. If you look into data, we'll find all sorts of correlations, such as this one. You know, number of serial killers as a function of chocolate consumption. So it would be very dangerous to live in Switzerland. And if you argue from the point of view of predictive policing, we should better put all the people who eat a lot of chocolate in prison, you know, because they could turn into rampage killers. And to make it a little bit even more funny, to show the level of some of the big data analytics that have happened in the past. Now, we can certainly do it better than we have to, that's my point. There's a number of forest fires, such as the one the beast in Canada right now. Number of forest fires increases with the number of children eating ice cream. And so, you know, that suggests that big data analytics, from that point of view, if you would do predictive analytics, we would better put ice cream eating children to jail, right? Now, this sounds like a joke, of course, and in some sense it is, but unfortunately, these kind of things do happen. Let's take another example, 23andMe. You can send a probe of your skin or whatever to the company to figure out your genes. It would list several diseases and what's the probability that you would get this disease or even die of it, right? And then people have done that, actually. And one of them was Angelina Jolie, famous actress. She said, now, knowledge is power. And what she did is she said, okay, I have a defect genome. And what she did is she got rid of her breast because she thought she would get cancer. So she got operated. And the question is now, was that a wise thing or a stupid thing? And some people say, you know, this is probably a stupid thing, this shouldn't be an example for other people. And in fact, remarkably, the US Health Authority has forbidden the sale of those 23andMe tests. And they don't do such a thing very often, you know, because USA is liberal and you wouldn't interfere with the market if you don't have to. So what went wrong? Well, some scientists started to send their probes to several of these companies. And according to what they got back, those letters that they got, and then they would die of different things according to different companies. You know, so what was presented as an absolute truth following from the data, you know, was this implicit truth that Chris Anderson was talking about, that was not there. It was not reliable. In fact, there was a recent big study with, I think, hundreds of thousands of people. I was asking people how healthy they were, and then they did these genetic tests, and turned out there were certain people who had serious genetic defects, so they should have been terribly ill, but they were absolutely healthy. Now that's something that scientists couldn't imagine before, but somehow the body seems to be an adaptive system that can deal with all sorts of things. So, you know, we should be careful how we use data, and in particular, of course, insurance companies and banks and police and secret services want to separate good and bad risks. Yeah? Sure. But what happens, even with big data, is that you have an overlap of these data crowds. And it means there will be errors of first and second kind, false alarms, and alarms that don't go off. And we have seen both cases actually in connection with terror, right? There have been some terror attacks that haven't been predicted and prevented, even though it turns out those individuals were in list of terror suspects. And there were other cases where terror attacks were predicted and they didn't happen. Now it turns out that for every terrorist that does something very bad, there are hundreds of people on those suspect lists that will never do anything bad. And that's actually that produces this problem that you don't see the forest for the trees, right? There's so many people, you don't know whom to go after first. And so it's not reliable, and that's the problem. Now there was a reason why the wise king would often fail to take wise decisions. And what we can see is that even though we have more and more data and can take evidence-based decisions, data volume overtakes processing power. In fact, the percentage of data that can be processed goes down with time. We can process less and less of the data that we produce. That means there's a lot of dark data in a sense, right? We could look at anything we want very precisely, but we need to decide what we want to look at, and that creates a flashlight effect. So we would see certain things very precisely, but we would overlook other things, such as the financial crisis that was not foreseen by most people, the Arab Spring, apparently, the crisis in Ukraine, and also the response to Ebola was way too late. So for all those cases, most likely there were data hinting at these events before, but you know, we didn't pay attention to them. That was this flashlight effect. And so there's this other problem that more knowledge does not necessarily mean more power. So there are companies like Recorded Future that claim to know what you would do in the future. In 90% of cases, so for sure they know you're sitting here now. We have regular schedules and that makes us predictable in many respects. But still, that doesn't mean we could predict the future of society. Now, interaction can change everything, and everyone knows this. So one day we'll meet the person of your life, you fall in love, and that changes your life for sure. We know this. And if you're a powerful person, will change the lives of many more people, right? The French say, church la femme, look for the woman now, because they would tell their husbands what to do. Anyway, so That's why top-down control of society doesn't work well. Even if we can control the single parts, there are interaction effects, and that can produce emergent phenomena, such as these phantom traffic jams. We could prevent it even if we were able to look into the brains of people, we could read their minds. And in fact, the mathematics that allows us to understand these phenomena doesn't need to know anything about people's psychology or thinking or, you know, whatever motivates them. But what we know is that above a certain critical density, small variations in the speed would be amplified and would trigger off a domino or cascade effect. And so that creates systemic instability. And even though all those drivers have all the information that they need, and they have good technology, modern cars, and they're well educated, and have a driver's license, and they have the very best intentions to avoid this from happening, to prevent this, it happens because of systemic instability and this cascading effect, right? And that happens in other systems too. In fact, most of our unsolved problems are of this kind. Systemic instability, such as in social dilemma situations, cooperation would actually be good for everyone, but cooperation is not stable in the very same way as the free traffic flow in the circle was not stable. So it breaks down, there's erosion of cooperation, and that produces finally a tragedy of the commons, which would mean overfishing, exploitation of resources, environmental pollution, and other kinds of problems. And we find similar instabilities in supply chains, in the world economy, where we have booms and recessions, in spreading of crime, in the occurrence of crowd disasters, where usually nobody wants to kill anyone, but it could end with the deaths of hundreds of people, in fact. So that means the situation obviously gets out of control, right? Same thing with conflicts. And that can be personal or between nations or cultures. Like most divorces have not been planned, you know. That's just something got out of control in your personal relationships, and so you had to divorce yourself. And that can happen also between countries. Relationships can get out of control if there's systemic instability. And same thing with revolutions. So when there is systemic instability, a small local perturbation can eventually mess up the system because of cascading effects. And given the global, highly networked systems of today, that could mean that there are global impacts. The entire planet could be mixed up by this type of phenomena, as the financial crisis, for example, shows. Lehman Brothers went bankrupt, and that triggered the bankruptcy of many more banks, hundreds of banks, and that created losses of hundreds of billions of dollars. Things that didn't happen, but that do happen because systems haven't been designed in a way to stop these cascading effects. Then finally, more power does not necessarily mean more success. You know, and it's probably now questioned, the United States is the most powerful country in the world. But in the aftermath of September 11, the wars on Afghanistan and Iraq didn't end quite as expected. And instead, what happened is tensions spread all over the region, and today we have problems in Syria, but not only there, right? It's an absolutely unsolved problem so far, and has created terrorism, so people feel threatened in all sorts of countries, and has created a major refugee crisis, and that is a cascading effect that has extended over many years and over many sectors of society, and is now hitting us, in fact. So we need to understand these phenomena much better, right? And the question is, would artificial intelligence fix the world? And some people think, you know, in about 20 years' time, we'll have machines that overtake human capacity. Some people think it takes 40 years or 100 years. Some people think maybe just 5. I think we're pretty close, actually. And that's not necessarily bad. We have already better chess players since a long time, better workers, better drivers, better doctors. I'm talking about IBM Watson. Watson knows much more than we could ever read and know. And so the question is really, after the automation of production and the production of self-driving cars, would the automation of society be next? And could society be run like a giant machine? And if you wanted to do that, you know, we would need to know what are all those different pieces, how do they interact, how can they be controlled, and what's behind this idea is basically a cybernetic vision of society, and Chile was the first country to come up with such an implementation. So they ask companies to report them how much they produce of what kinds of products, and they said, okay, produce more of that, reduce the production of those products, and so on. And this way they create feedback effects. And at that time, however, they didn't have the technology to handle the human factor that produced chaos, in a sense, right? It was unpredictable. But no, the idea was taken further from there, so it still exists, and Singapore has taken it up and implemented it, and they consider themselves a social laboratory, and it's also being done in other countries, and basically the technology that's being used, one of them is deep learning, and deep learning would just be fed with all the data about the society and the economy, the health data, what you're doing, and so on, and you know, it should basically create a digital copy and learn the patterns to predict what's going on. But not only predict it, but also, as I said, people tend to be uncontrollable, to control people. Because that is a precondition to make the world predictable, right? And how could that be done? Well, basically, with personalized information. And Google does that. It does it for personalized advertisement. And in fact, we are overloaded with information that makes us easy to manipulate, because we want to be told in many situations what we should do. We don't have the time to figure it out. You know? And so we end up in a situation where we are remotely controlled by interests that we don't know about. And in fact, this is something that media have started to report about. Machines take over power in the internet. Are we already steered by computers? And yeah, the question is, are we marionettes in the end? Is freedom gone? You know, there are some books that are recommended to read in this connection. And the science behind this is actually behaviorism. And Skinner was one of the first to work on this. So he produced these Skinner boxes where he put animals inside and presented them rewards or punishment, food or electrical shocks, to make them do certain kind of things. You know, it's called conditioning. And this is being done with us now. We're being conditioned. Companies like Google make millions of experiments every day. Now, what makes people click here or there? And we're experimental rabbits in a sense for this, and our Skinner box is the filter bubble that is created around us. And the way we see the world is produced increasingly by others. And that can be used to manipulate our vision of the world, our attention, our decisions, our opinions, our emotions, our behavior. And it's also interesting for politics. And the question is it good or is it bad? And as always, you know, every tool can be used in good and bad ways, so there's no simple answer to this, right? But what one can say is that the filter bubble effect produces a situation that makes it more difficult to think out of the box, to be fundamentally innovative, come up with totally different ideas, right? And it also produces a polarization effect, as we see it in many parts of the world. And besides, big nudging can't do certain kind of things. Basically, most things that are related to interactions, nudging is not very good at. You know, family, friends, solidarity, social capital, culture, security, peace, innovation, and jobs for all. And then the next question is, would we just be manipulated? You know, that doesn't hurt directly. We might just lose our innovation capacity, which is bad enough, but would we also be punished? You know, would it hurt? And the question, the fact is that nudging, even if it uses all that data about you that has been collected, it's not good enough to make you behave in a healthy way and in an environmental friendly way. So we need more powerful approaches, these people would say. And personalized pricing could be one of those things, you know. So the reward and punishment of the Skinner box, it could be implemented into this, which kind of condition you to do certain kind of things. And if this is not good enough, then there's still the citizen score. And basically there, whatever you do gets a plus or minus point. Even what you click on the internet, what news you read, what music you hear, the porn you watch, but also what your friends do and your family does and all these kind of things will enter your citizen score, and that determines the jobs you can get, the conditions, how much you have to pay for your loan, and also where you can travel and all these kind of things. And this is on the way, and similar things are happening also in Western countries. For example, airport security is using similar systems, and they try to identify suspicious people. And how it works is basically everything which is not average would be considered potentially suspicious. So you just go for everything that is not average. That could be moaning and laughing and combing your hair, actually. It's not my invention. I didn't come up with this. This is what you could read on the news. And obviously, this is not working very well. People know this, but they're still using it because they don't have anything better, it seems. That brings us to predictive policing, you know, the ice cream eating children. And of course, people who do more dangerous things like rob other people, break into buildings, the burglary, and all these kind of things. And so people would be arrested before they commit a crime. And the question is, how well is this working? Some people say it's just reinforcing prejudice. I haven't seen data about this, but. Certainly one needs to be careful if one wants to be scientific. My feeling is this is not necessarily scientific, but some people just want to do it anyway. And so the sentences that people would get would also depend on things they haven't even done yet, just based on predictions. But remember, you know, one predictive analytics algorithm could have a different outcome than another one, as we've seen with the genetic tests, right? So there's no scientific validity, it seems, so far. And as I said, not only what you're doing matters, but also what the people around you do matters as well. And that means you could get in trouble because of other people. So we might be losing everything, like freedom, human dignity, assumed innocence, justice, happiness, democracy, peace, our jobs, and as I will show you, even our lives. And I think, you know, it's really time to say stop. We should be using these technologies in more reasonable ways. Now, big data is fine and artificial intelligence is fine, but how to use it? Now, this is the big challenge, and that requires ethics and science, yeah? And maybe also new kind of technology, how to build these systems. There's now a World Economic Forum initiative about can robots be ethical, right? So they realize these problems. Actually, we have raised these questions. So what's the root of all these problems? Why have people built all those surveillance systems, all those powerful technologies? Because we are in trouble. We are in serious trouble. Our lifestyle is not sustainable. In fact, we are overusing resources by a factor of 3.5. USA even more. Altogether, the entire world is overusing resources too. So, you know, we can sustain this way of living for some time, but not forever. Nitrogen is falling short, phosphorus is falling short. This is needed for fertilizer, for food production. Water is a problem. And in fact, one of the first studies to look into this was the Club of Rome's Limits to Growth study, heavily criticized, and in a sense it's wrong, of course details don't fit well, but people have started thinking about it. The US president has commissioned a report, and they have made their own analysis, and that created the Global 2000 study. And they basically confirmed the principal conclusions of this other study. And since then, we didn't hear much about this, and everything has the feeling, okay, where's the problem? No, there's no problem. But maybe there is. And what the numbers say is that population will hit a maximum and then go down dramatically. We'll see a collapse of the economy according to those projections. They might be wrong, and of course they have underlying assumptions, and in fact if we don't want to run into these scenarios, we need to change the boundary conditions, and now the underlying mechanics of the system. This is what I will talk about, because if we don't want to get into the situation where a lot of people will die, we need to change the system. This is pretty clear. And so far, the predictions are pretty reasonably compatible with data. It's claimed. But you know, the biggest change is happening here, and it's not clear whether it has to come this way or we can make a difference, right? And I think our lives should be committed to this question: can we make a difference? Now, can we change this scenario so people wouldn't have to die? Now, I've been asking myself the question, now, is it all wrong? Do we need to be concerned or not? And then I came to the conclusion, yes, we do have to be concerned. In fact, a lot of big business has built billion-dollar industries to address these challenges. They've done that for several decades. They've done their best. And the impression that I get is they haven't fixed the problem fully. They do think that we will run into serious trouble. That's my assessment. And in fact, if you look at how the planet looks like, you know, it's not become better. There is a serious water issue. There's a global warming issue, and this is the Aral Lake, and you see it's almost not there anymore, so we have a problem with the way we're using water. But not only this, we're running short of resources, right? And that's why the NASA is trying to come up with a Mars mission, and Elon Musk tries to do this, and Amazon tries to do this, and I guess Google tries to do that too. So there's a race for new resources, for a new level of globalization, and to get those resources. There is a US Space Act that allows you now to mine asteroids. And why do we have this? Because we need new resources, you know? And this is a desperate race. A desperate race, and it's desperate because within the last 150 years, driven by oil, the world population has increased by a factor of six. Sixfold population, all driven by oil. And of course, CO2 emissions went up with the size of that world population. So if we now want to cut carbon emissions, we need to cut oil and gas and coal consumption. That's clear to everyone, right? And that means how many people will this earth still be able to carry with less oil and gas and coal? So we will have this, will we have this carrying capacity problem, that if we reduce use of oil, the carrying capacity of this earth will go down? Now, this is kind of a logical consequence if we don't find a way to compensate for this problem. No. If we don't go about global warming, one-sixth of all species will die. This is the projection, you know, that will be the worst extinction event within a 50 or 100 years time period, like a split second from the point of view of a planet's history. The biggest extinction event since the dinosaurs extinct. So there are these kind of books, Learning to Die in the Anthropocene, and usually I wouldn't take such books seriously because they're books about everything, but I got this hint from somebody I need to take seriously, and I think this is basically the challenge that we need to face. So what are our options? You know, if 1 billion people or 2 billion people or whatever would have to die, you know, then the question is, how would they die? I mean, this is the implication of that problem, right? Would there be a global war? Would there be a global pandemics? Would people use euthanasia? Would we have any of those systems or a revolution? Or would we have a new system that manages to come up with a higher carrying capacity with less resources? This is what I'm up to. But we would need to build it. We need to change the mechanism of this world, of our markets, of our economy, to be able to let the same number of people survive with less resources. So what could be our survival strategy? Well, the point is really to get from this scenario where a lot of people would die to this scenario where hopefully only a few, or in the ideal case, nobody would die. There's a lot of discussion about this ethical dilemma recently in connection with self-driving cars, but my feeling is people are talking actually about a much bigger problem here. And they would design artificial intelligence systems to decide about who would have to die, not everyone can survive, and who would live on. This is the question that's in the air. And according to the legal situation today, if that was the situation you were in, we were not allowed to make this person die to save those people's lives. However, what is allowed to be done is if we're not talking about concrete specific people who would die, but about probabilities of survival or die, you know, you're allowed to change this scenario towards that scenario. And it's even our obligation to do this. Right? So the question is, can we find the door to a new future? A new kind of economy and society that would allow us to get to this scenario that would allow more people to survive? And would we manage to close those other doors that would run our society into traps, the revolution trap, or the trap of a third world war? Would we manage this? That's the question. I don't know, this is the solution that I'd like to propose. Upgrade democracy and capitalism, because those have been the most successful systems in the past. They're very efficient, flexible, adaptive, resilient. Yeah? They have all the freedom that is needed for high innovation rates. If you want to master this challenge, we need to have more innovation, not less. We need to have more freedom in tech, right? Because freedom is a precondition for innovation. And then, of course, there's this more networked world, and that requires us to come up with a more systemic thinking. If you want an ecosystem thinking, where everyone, every company, every nation, every culture, every ethnicity would be part of this ecosystem and nature too, and we would need to learn how to combine the potentials of all this to solve the problem. So I think really the paradigms of the future are co-creation, co-revolution, and collective intelligence. Yes, and the evidence says, you know, freedom promotes creativity and innovation, and the most diverse economies are the most successful ones. You know, and any top-down systems, be it fascism or communism or feudalism, reduces diversity and therefore reduces chances that will make it that we manage to master the challenges ahead. And in fact, you know, Albert Einstein said we cannot solve our problems within the same kind of thinking that created them. We need to have a paradigm shift, a new kind of thinking. And if there is a new approach, which is compatible with self-determination, democracy, free entrepreneurship, and this is distributed data storage and control, distributed AI, I would say. And we're working on this, you know, Evangelos and his team, NervousNet has exactly this motivation, using the Internet of Things to produce big data for everyone, so we can all make better decisions and make the contributions to the solution, to the solution of the problems that we're faced with. And yeah, the idea is to use all the sensors and the smartphones and add other external sensors and connect all of this, but build a distributed system that's scalable and that's not so easy to bring down by hacking. That means a resilient system and a system that we can trust and that we can control. So we have, again, more control over our lives. You know, if other people control us, then we lose control, right? We cannot determine the outcomes anymore. I can't believe that this would be good on the long run. So the idea is to build the Internet of Things as a citizen web, or sometimes I say we, the people, and our Internet of Things. And I believe the United States has become more and more sympathetic, actually, for these kind of ideas. That's how I read the news. And one can do a lot of interesting things with this. Real-time measurement, greater awareness, advanced science, support self-organizing systems, and support collective intelligence and digital assistance. But what I'd like to conclude with is capitalism 2.0. a capitalism that's liberal, democratic, participatory, social, and ecological. Now, I mean, we could bring it all together now. It's possible. The technology is there. We just need to do it. So it's kind of clear that if we need to live on less resources, then we need to circulate those resources more efficiently. We need to build a circular economy, have less waste, and feed the resources back into the system. And the sharing economy would be part of this circular economy. You know, it's interesting that the sharing economy just comes up now in this financial crisis, but I think it would make potentially a major contribution to the solution of the problems we're in. And of course, we should map the resources and where they are and who uses them. And in fact, we started to build an app, which is in the early stage, but anyway, it's to demonstrate that we can do this also in a crowdsourced way. Warm Piles is this app. But then I think we need to go even a step further. So measuring the effects, the external effects of interactions between people, between companies, between companies in the environment. This can now be done with the Internet of Things, and NervousNet would potentially do this, right, in perspective. But this is not enough. We need to create feedback loops. We need to create an incentive system, in fact, a multi-dimensional incentive system that allows you to come up with a differential, much more differentiated control of processes. In fact, I'm thinking of self-organizing processes and self-regulating processes and the spirit of liberalism. But it requires still the right kind of platform, and I'm calling this platform Finance 4.0 or socio-ecological finance. And this is because it would give a price or a value to those externalities that would be measured by us. And that's the kind of information that's needed to make the economy more efficient, more circular, to reduce waste, to create more benefit, more cooperation, more peace, less conflict, you know. So that's the idea. So we would not just have one currency, we would add further currencies, you know, let the dollar be there and the euro be there, but we would add additional currencies that measure noise and pollution and whether something is socially beneficial, you know, employment, for example, ecological implications. All of that would be measured by different currencies, and so we could have these differential feedback loops to have a much better bottom-up self-control of that system. And in fact, you know, we need to do this, because the capitalism of today doesn't work anymore. You can read it on the newspapers. Now, we have zero interest rate. So the incentive system of capitalism is gone. We have no growth. Since many years, you know, we are waiting for this global economic engine to restart. We're trying to boost it. We're putting trillions of dollars into this system. The Fed, the ECB, but the effects that they want to achieve are not there, unfortunately. Not to the extent they would like it to be. And so people are getting more and more desperate. And they're talking about things like helicopter money, you know, putting some money on your bank account to keep the economy going. Because companies are now concerned about your buying power. If you don't have enough buying power, it would be bad for them. It would be bad for rich people. It would be bad for everyone. It would just create this downward spiral, right? So we need to reform the financial system, no question. And so the idea that I'd like to propose is let people create money. by measuring the environment, by measuring these externalities, you would be rewarded with some money. And this can now be built. Bitcoin has shown it. Bottom-up creation of money can be built now. So we could marry blockchain technology with the Internet of Things on this NervousNet platform, a platform for everyone, to measure all those externalities, to value these externalities, to create feedback loops, to create this circular economy, to create the money that would raise from the bottom to the top, and it was passed by everyone, would create benefits for everyone. It would turn this digital desert that we're living in Europe, with very few companies that are visible on an international scale, into a digital rainforest where this abundance of data and of opportunities for everyone and a large degree of diversity, and where you can combine existing products and services through interoperability to build new services and products, and that would stimulate combinatorial innovations and all the jobs that we would need in times of automation. So, summarizing, if you go on as before, I think we will end in disaster, definitely. Loss of democracy could be the outcome, loss of freedom, mass unemployment, financial economic collapse, resource shortages, serious climate change, global war. And super intelligence can do certain kind of things. I acknowledge this. We should have these systems, but we shouldn't overestimate this system. They cannot do everything. We need additionally to digitally upgrade the socioeconomic system that we have. And the reason is this. Data volume is overtaking processing power. Systemic complexity, as we network the world, is overtaking data volume, because that goes up combinatorially. And that means top-down control gets lost, and that's what we're seeing. The last World Economic Forum basically concluded this. We lost control. And that's why we need to go towards distributed participatory control now. And it's time for a paradigm change to run the system in a new way, in a better way, a network, well-coordinated, distributed system of large autonomous systems rather than one big system. And so the question is, what are the perspectives that this would ever happen? Now, is this just fantasy of Professor Dirk Halbing? You know, is he dreaming, or will this happen? And of course, I cannot tell you for sure. But you know, I'm slightly more optimistic than pessimistic, and my optimism is increasing over time, I should say. People have been working on giving back control to people over their data. The World Economic Forum has proposed these personal data stores and compensating people for data. Here is an address of Barack Obama, who says, in this Consumer Data Privacy Bill of Rights, Americans have always cherished our privacy. From the birth of our republic, we assured ourselves protection against unlawful intrusion into our homes and our personal papers. Congress made it a crime to invade the privacy of the mails, and later we extended privacy protection to new modes of communication, such as the telephone, the computer, eventually email. And then came Snowden, and everyone said, okay, so how does that fit together? But we'll see that things have changed much more towards this way of thinking about systems, right? We've seen this UN Agenda 2030 to manage the challenges of the future, but they're giving us just 15 years for this. You know, this is a very short time period. And they're talking about strong institutions, and this is what I'm a little bit worried. So certainly agree overall with those goals. We need to do this, but the question is how to do it to be most successful. that's good news to the government in the US, wants you to help to do science experiments, citizen science on the rise, bottom-up participation, right? So this is coming up. Then the EU said, oh, maybe this exchange of personal data that we had in the past is not compatible with the constitution. And when this general court advocate said that, you know, within 1 week's time, Apple said, no, we protect your privacy, and Google turned itself into Alphabet. They reorganized themselves. Of course, they were prepared for this possibility that Europe would say, well, we insist on privacy, so they were ready for this. They were not sure it was coming because they were lobbying against this, but they were ready. So between the day where this general attorney was saying, I think we'll decide against it, and the core decision, that was 1 week later, all of this happened. And now we have EU data protection law. Since a few days it's ratified, so I think by in 2 years' time, basically, the new data protection law will have to be implemented by everyone, and it applies to everyone who does data business in Europe, right? So then came our Nature paper, Build Digital Democracy. And in fact, since then, a lot of teams, both European and US, have written proposals about this. Then came this Delft Program for Responsible Digital Future, this PhD program, and my talk in Berlin at the Falling Walls Conference about digital democracy, and our digital manifesto, and the Paris Agreement. But then the concerning thing was that there were also tendencies to build this strong state. That's the news that came before the 1st of January when Germany had this Sylvester trouble, you know. They were basically saying, you know, let's turn Germany into a strong state. And a lot of these things have happened in Germany and even more in other countries like France and Belgium and so on. But I've warned that we will need democracy to do a better job, and hopefully the politicians have understood and taken it seriously. So in the beginning of this year I had several articles on this, and then we had this epic encryption battle between Apple and the FBI, and some people saying that was just a genius trick of the United States to get everyone on board of privacy. I don't know. I mean, there are different interpretations of this, but in the end, you know, after Apple was attacked, everyone said, we stand united behind Apple, and we're in favor of privacy, and they started to get interested in privacy. You know, this is an interesting thing. And shortly later, Obama extended this US privacy protection to foreign citizens, European. So now we're back to the Consumer Privacy Bill of Rights. So it finally happened, but you know, it was an epic battle in a sense. And so we hope to be able to build this digital world to thrive, and that will be published in pan-European networks in a couple of days. I will be distributed basically to all administrations in Europe, and I've recently written this paper, which I'm now talking about. And shortly after this, I was prompted of this project, a global blockchain project called Fermat, which is building a peer-to-peer economy. So, you know, this is already on the way. It doesn't have the detailed finance 4.0 mechanism on board, but I think we are drifting towards this bottom-up economy, and with the TTIP leak, I think capitalism 2.0 has been dramatically weakened, and the White House is now looking into the way of how artificial intelligence should be used in future. And we've just had this event on the future of work here in Zurich, and Robert Reich, previous Minister of Work under the Clinton administration, if I remember right, is maybe that time, and when he starts speaking, everyone is bent and listens to him. And this is the summary of his talk. Basic income is the solution to three problems: lack of aggregate demand, buying power, that means the worries of companies, inequality, and insecurity that drives populism. And my feeling is, this was the event where they were checking out how do people think and feel about basic income. And I believe that business people and the US will probably push for something like this at the next World Economic Forum or so, because it seems like something that would have broad support and would solve a number of issues and stabilize the economy, the society, and politics at the same time. So there's hope, and you can make a contribution to a better future. Thank you.